Okay, who's next? We're running out of entertainers. Entertainment. Or ho'okupu.
Aloha mai kākou. Kalani opua ko inoa. I'm actually born and raised in Wai-Ana on this island, and I currently reside in Wakinikona in Washington State. We have a lot of lahui there as well. And so I guess my ho'okupu would just be a great mahalo to Oko Kekuni, Puhipau, and Leandra Wai. And honestly, I didn't have the privilege of knowing them personally in life, like many of the people here. But I was actually greatly influenced by their work. And it was Puhipau's video, Makua to Heal a Nation, that was filmed during the 90s, actually. And I had a few relatives living on the beach. And after seeing that film later in life, it allowed me to see the issue of homelessness in a different light. It allowed me to see it from the perspective of as a Kanaka Maoli, and allowed me to see the land struggle from beaches on our tents on the beaches as our people reclaiming our ʻAina. And so today, as a doctoral student at the University of Washington, I decided to come back home and to live in a tent with my lahui, with my people. And so I've always inspired by the work of Kekuni, that steadfast, that onipa'a, that strength to stand up and say a'ole no more. Leandra Wai, who was living at Makua in the 90s, really inspired me and allowed me to think about ʻAina as sacred. And these pu'uhonua, these places of refuge, right, which is part of the traditional land-based system here in Hawaii, and to see that and remember that by actually becoming a part of that space, as I am now at Wai'anae, at pu'uhonua o Wai'anae village. And Puhipau's work is just incredible, and I'm always inspired to make ethnographic films eventually. And so I just want to say mahalo to these three warriors of the lahui. And I just want to say mahalo to everyone for coming. And thank you for allowing me to be in this space. Mahalo.
Okay, so at this time, we'll probably just put on a little bit of music, take a little bit of a break. But if those of you, I'm not sure if everyone knows, but we're planning to stay overnight tonight, so those of you who want to. And as soon as it gets dark enough, we're going to put on some Namakaoka ʻAina videos. We're planning to show the tribunal. And Joan has put together short video clips of Kekuni, Puhipau, and Leandra. So we will be setting up a screen and projector a little bit later once the light comes down. And we have two brothers on their way here to join us. Just a heads up, Kalekoa Kaeo and Kaho'okahi Kanuha both are flying in this afternoon to join us. So we're kind of excited to see those brothers and hear what they have to say. I guess I'll share a short story since we're in storytelling mode. My wahine Camille and my son Andre Boy, who was probably about 7 or 8 years, took a drive out to Wai'anae. Coming back from Maui, I was excited to go back to the Wai'anae coast in the mid-90s. Talk about houselessness, homelessness. I had done Sirara High School, Kauai High School. I had no really real options. I didn't know what I was gonna do, so I joined the military. which was somewhat, you know, I wouldn't do it again. But I did 8 years in the military. I got out in 1996. It was July 19th. June 19th, Father's Day. I got out and I had no money and I had nowhere to go. So I grabbed my dive gear, one tent, and I headed out to Wai'anae and lived on the beaches too. Keao Beach Park, Makaha. And then later, met a girl and we had a son together, my youngest son, my second oldest son, Andre Jr. And so I spent time on the Wai'anae coast. And my son's family is from Nanakuli. So when I came back from Maui in 2005, I was excited to go check it out. So we took a drive out. We ended up at Makua, of course. And we were driving down the side road, the dirt road, and I seen this, all these rock structures. And I was amazed. Prior to that, when I was living in Wai'anae in 96, 97, 98, I had met this stone carver, yeah? Hanalei Hapi. We all know Hanalei Hapi, and he had inspired me to do stonework. So now, 10 years later, I'm back. And I see all these pohaku walls and all the work that she had done, you know, stacking rock. And so I said, wow, look at that nice pohaku. Look, I wonder what she's building. So me and my wahine Camille walk up and approach her. And I tell her, wow, nice your pohaku. And Leandra kind of looks at me, nods her head, kind of gives me the cold shoulder. And so we kind of stand there and I'm trying to start a conversation with her, but she's not interested. And then I point at a certain pohaku and she tells me, "Hey, no point." I'm like, "Oh, wow, sorry." So we didn't get a good reception from Leandra that first 10 minutes until somehow in that conversation on the beach in front of all her pohaku, we started talking about a kakabil. And she said, "Yeah, you know, there's this group. They're organizing against a kakabil. And there's this guy. He's coming, he's organizing." And she looked at me and she goes, "Oh, it's you." And I said, "Oh," she said, "the group Huipu." And I said, "Oh yeah, that's me." And then her whole demeanor changed. And she immediately stood up and welcomed us and took us on a royal tour of all her pohaku and took us across in the back trail where she had her her little garden area and gave us the whole tour. And we always joke about that, how, you know, Leandra never know us. And she had reason to be cautious. And I remember her telling me, "Hey, no, just take pohaku, eh?" But from that point on, though, we became friends and she always remembered us. And some years later, we had a huipu retreat at Makua Beach. And we camped out there and had a organizing retreat. And she was always very gracious and very nice to us after that initial moment. Once she found out, she got to know who we were. Yeah. So that was our introduction with Leandra. On another note, a little bit later, we went camping down Makua, me and Camille and my son. And we were just going to do a quick overnighter, so we had a pop-up like this. We made them low on the beach, had the kayak and fishing poles, and we just were sleeping on the sand. And in the middle of the night, I woke up to this roaring sound. I was like, "What the hell?" I started smelling smoke. And I kind of looked around. There was this brush fire like at 2 o'clock in the morning coming right at us. I would be like, from here to the coconut trees. And I yelled, "Fire!" And we jumped up and we barely had time. The embers were burning through the canopy, falling on us. And we just grabbed everything into the truck, threw them in the truck, And good thing we had four-wheel drive, and we drove off down the beach and made it out of this brush fire that was just, like, literally 50 feet away. But that was an experience because it was at that brush fire that was we kind of escaped with our lives. The only place that we could go to that had light was the military installation across the street. So we drove out, got on the main road, and, you know, pulled over in the light and had to repack our truck and make sure everything was pa'a. But it was kind of at that moment that I realized, I had a realization that the only light, the only infrastructure facilities is, you know, was the military installation there, and that it was really occupying the biggest, most lush valley on the Wai'anae coast, you know. But it was that nighttime experience that we had that was the only place to go. And where once there was people living there, there may have been houses, there would have been community, but there wasn't. There was just a gate with a floodlight, you know. And for me, that was a powerful moment. So anyways, that's my story. If you want to have anybody else come up and share, the mic's open. If not, we will put some music on. I see that our brother Kalekoa showed up, as usual. I'm sure he has a very fiery speech for us shortly. But if not, stand by for some music. Mahalo.
Hi, my name is Titi Lua, and I'm from upcountry Maui, Makawa. And I'm so blessed to be here today and just to witness the stories and everything that these three heroes of our Lahui left. And I'm just so proud to be Hawaiian, to be here, you know. It's so awesome to be here. And even though it's a sad day, it's also a beautiful day. And I want to picture that they're with Keakua and they're like on top of a mountain and they're just seeing all the beauty that is happening in this place right now. So I just want to sing this song. It's called Haleakala from my mountain to all of you. To watch the sunrise.
political science PhD candidate at the University of Hawaii in Manoa, doing research in Hawaiian Kingdom, in areas related to the Hawaiian Kingdom. And Kekuni had an impact on him, and he's really doing some critical research for the community through the Hawaiian Society of Law and Politics. And so I'd like to invite up now Lawrence Gonshore, PhD candidate, UH Manoa Political Science Department, to just share some of his Ike that was also inspired in some ways by Kekuni, because he was an inspiration to us all. Mahalo. Lawrence.
Hey, Mahalo. To meet this wonderful man and was able to spend be in touch with him during the last decade or so of his life, and he really inspired me in many ways. For those who don't know me, I came here in 2003. I'm live now in Hawaii for 13 years, and I'm from Germany originally. And my first contact with the Pacific happened through Tahiti. And so I spent some time in Tahiti, and then my friends in Tahiti told me when I was going traveling back from Tahiti to Europe, to Germany, they told me, hey, if you go to Hawaii, you gotta meet this guy, Dr. Kekuni Blasdell. He's awesome. So I did, and just the very first day, total stranger, didn't even speak good English, kind of trying to like get myself around Hawaii, and then this wonderful gentleman invites me to his house, serves me food. I planned staying there maybe for an hour to get to know him, and then I ended up staying the whole day, the rest of the day at his house, and he just wouldn't let me go, and we were talking story, and he would like serve me more food and more juice, and it was just absolutely wonderful. And then pretty much from day one of staying in Hawaii, I attended the Kekuni's Thursday meetings. And because I already had this connection to Tahiti before I came to Hawaii, it was absolutely perfect to talk story with Kekuni, because he had these very kind of deep connections to the rest of Polynesia as well. He traveled all the time to Aotearoa, he traveled to Tahiti several times, the islands of Micronesia. He was just really knowledgeable about not just Hawaii, but the Pacific Ocean in general, and not just generally, but he knew all the sovereignty activists, all the independence guys, all the people fighting for indigenous rights and all of that all over the Pacific. So that was really wonderful to to learn from him, and I just learned so much just attending these meetings. And eventually it set me on a course to, I guess, on my academic course to study, first joined the master's program at UH, and then the PhD program, and Shane said, I'm almost done with my PhD right now. And again, I mean, Kekuni had such an important influence. Without him, I would never have getting this inspiration to study so much, to really and also to question all the all the kind of master narrative, and people tell me, oh, this is that and this is like that, and then you gotta really gotta question, like, who tells this story, who makes that history, and not just here but in other islands too, the French have a master narrative of Tahiti. You gotta go behind that to understand what's actually going on. The Chileans have a master narrative about Rapa Nui. That's all nonsense, but you got to talk to the people there to find out what's really going on. So, to make a long story short, one of the things that Kekuni, inspired me to do was to research the relationship between the Hawaiian Kingdom and the other islands of Polynesia. And that's what my dissertation is all about. And it's just, again, you gotta, once you go beyond, once you learn this critical thinking, which Kekuni taught me to, there's a whole new layer of information that opens up. And so I happened to see all of that, how actually Hawaii in the 19th century was not just one independent kingdom, it's way more. Hawaii was actually a power in the world. Hawaii was the Pacific power. The Hawaiian Kingdom was the one nation that was starting to federate all of Oceania under its leadership. And then pretty much when the over. So my one of my topics that I'm one of my metaphors that I'm using is that once the United States took over Hawaii, they didn't just take out Hawaii. They actually beheaded Oceania. They beheaded the Pacific supranation in the Pacific that was being formed at that time. So it was the beheading of Oceania when the United States took over. So it was all thanks to Kekuni that I started this going on that course, and I hope he'll be with me. His spirit will help me go further, and of course I want to share my knowledge and try to educate other people and hopefully make a little contribution to just like all the people who have spoken here before me. I just hope I can help overcome this indoctrination and misinformation that's out there, and really help you guys and other people in the Pacific to get that sense of that pride, that sense of kind of being a powerful nations in the world, get that back and overcome this Western colonial mindset that has been prevalent for so long. So in closing, I would like to little story. So about a month ago, Kekuni passed away. One of my best friends, who was also very good friends with Kekuni, I was stuck in writing my dissertation, totally like oblivious to the entire world. But so this friend called me up and said, "Hey, you know what happened? Uncle Kekuni passed away." Of course, immediate change of I couldn't finish that chapter in my dissertation that night, which I wanted to. Like, it was kind of totally saddening. But I just had that. So I went to sleep kind of saddened, and then over that night I got this strong urge to write a kanaka. Now, I'm not from Hawaii, I'm not raised in the Hawaiian culture. I did learn the language, but still it's not, it doesn't flow as easy as with somebody who is from here. But I felt that's my kuleana to do. So I took 2 days off of my dissertation writing, and I looked up historical kanaka. I took my Hawaiian dictionary, I remembered everything from my Hawaiian language classes, and then I composed this kanaka. And as I said, it's probably not perfect. There might be really good Hawaiian poets here who know to write these things better than me, but I still feel it's my kuleana to share this with you guys. So here I am. He kanaka aloha no Richard Kekuni akana Blasdell. Ue kalani. Ue ka ʻaina, ue ka lahui, wahala ke kauka. Kauka no ke ola kino, a kauka no hoʻi no ke ola o ka lahui. Ana ʻole kona aloha I ka ʻaina, kona aloha hoʻi I ka lahui, a kona olu olu no hoʻi I nā kānaka a pau. Hā mama hoʻi kona hale, e hoʻokipa I ka lehulehu. Hoʻolohe. Hoʻolohe mau ia kona leo nahenahe. Aloha, kipa mai. He puʻuhu noa no ka hale ka ʻohinani no ka poe aloha ʻaina. Piha no ke aloha ma ka loʻihi o kona ola. Ua lilo I kauka kōkua oia no ka poe āsia. I hoʻoneo ia e ke kawa nui. Kukua no I ka poʻe kepani, I luku ia I nā pōka atomi. Anō ka piha o kona aloha, wa hānai mai I kekahi keiki kepani. Nui no hoʻi kona akamai, ma ka ʻoihana laʻau lapaʻau, ʻoia hoʻi ka ʻoihana kauka. Nā kona kumu Kilolani ma ke kula kamehameha, I ʻike mua I kona akamai kui kawā. Haʻalele akula I kona one hana o aloha, a hale I ka ʻaina hau ona moana wailoa, wa ka moku puni hono nui no ke kula kauka o ke kako. Ma laila no I loaʻa a iaia he huina pili aloha, aliluaʻe ia pilina hoʻoipo I ʻohana. Wa Kekuni ke kane, o Irene ka wahine, hana o he keiki wahine o nā lani, hanai mai he keiki kane o Mitch. Hoʻi mai la I keia nei pai ʻaina aloha, a kuhia ia ke kula la aula paʻao o ke kula nui o Hawaiʻi. Nui nō kona hana ma kēia kula nui, a lilo I poʻo kui kawā no hoʻi o ka hale kamakakua kalani. He koa nō hoʻi ʻoia no ka ea o ka ʻaina. A lilo I alakaʻi kaulana no ka ʻoihana hoʻokū o koʻa. Ka hua a ʻela I ke komike no ka hoʻokolokolo nui o Kanaka maoli. A pai o e hiki ai ka hoʻi hoʻi I ke ʻōpuni. O ka mō I wahine aloha I hoʻokahuli ʻia I ka poʻe loko ʻino. Huakaʻi a ʻela ma ka moana nui e kipa aku I nā hoahanao o Hawaiʻi nui a kea. Kanaka maoli, tangata maori, taʻata maʻohi, hoʻokahi nō lāhui. A ʻoi loa kona nui o nā lāhui o ka honua. Kokua a kula e hoʻohala wai I a poʻe o ka moana nui nei, a kuʻē aku I nā mana hoʻokolonaio. Ue nā hoku o Oceania. Ue nā moku o ka moana nui. Ue nā kanaka, ngāta ngāta e te mau taʻata. Wahala ke koa nahe nahe, he kupuna kupaianaha o ka pā ki pika. He kanikau no Kekuni.
E te hopo a tāne, e te mauli ola. E ola hoʻi, o mauli ola. E ola ia o e tāne tū me lono, oia, ho oia, e ola. O te tāne hua vai a kua kena, o ka linaka vai haulu, o ka huli o ka olu. O ka pae ai he au au ka mana o he e au lolo te pō o piha o piha piha o piha u o piha o piha e o piha o te to onua pa ai kalan u leva ke au ya kumoli po ka po po no e anu au he no maui ne maui nu ya kamae e kune wau mamu au ko e ka lehu lehu ka poe kia nai no ke aina o ahu ka kuhi heba veli nā alo veli nā me ke aloha nui e aloha e aloha e o maila o lailai ka pai o kane ka pō kini kini pō tita mahu Hana o lai lai nohi a kapapa, hana o tamahina he kāne, hana o kumule kāne. O kamakalua he wahine, o poele a o lokamo, poele a o lokamo, vehi vela vehilo, hoi ho lai lai, nohi a kāne. Hana o haki he wahine, hana o halia he wahine, hana o hakea he kāne. Hana o kabuki muka muke ke ke kukuku nenevo. Moku monu mu muliana mu muli valiana kāne ka muli ka muli ke o kamai, veveli vali, pekan ho hana o keki. Imu a yaki, imu ya kāne. Kālawa kamahana o lanila, puka, aloha, velina me ke aloha. Ke kumai nei wau, keia ahi ahi, me ka haaheo, me ke kupaa. Elike no mena leo, o ka po ihala, I haalele, ke ao, A hoʻi nō I ka pō. Ka pō I kūpuna poi aumākua. A nui a lehu lehu. Nā hoa aloha ʻaina. ka ho aloha aina oia i'o. I launa puai, ma ke aino hali i maile, ma ka malu, ka hale ali'i o Iolani. Ho mana a elo wau, ke la poe hoa, anko tami maunu pau, velina me ke aloha. Kamaka huki lani vana ofen. Aloha nui. And ti pege hao ros. Upa amau. Aloha nui. A meke alelo kila. Oi hoi. O kwaipuna pre-jean. Meke aloha. Anui alehu lehu kapoe o keia wahi. Aku aku mai. Ko wahi I launa puai. Me lako apau. Ma kea aina. Kea aina hali I maile. No leila. Te hali aloha kea. Ha upu ka manao. Ku aloha. Ke la poe. Aloha aina oia I o. A peia puno hoi me kea poe. I halaku nei. O Kauka. Kekuni Blasdell. Nui wale ki aloha, ke ia kanaka. Kupa ai ke aloha aina. Kana e, no kona ano kanaka. He kanaka aloha, akahai. Nui o ka ike, e na e. Haa haa mauli no oia. He kumu, he alii mauli no oia. No ka koa pao. Wehele oia, a huipu me kia poe aloha aina oia I o. Brother Puhipau, like no, ia manawa, makahui ana ma kia, aina ke kahi o hali I maile. Mahalo nui wau iae me kāna wahine o John, kola oa. Kupa'a, ka malama ana, ke ike, nā maka o ka aina, no kā kō. I ho'o na awau ia, kā kō. Mamuio, ka laua hana, ka malama ana, nā kū e liki ole, nā hala vai, nā hae olelo liki ole. Heia pume na ki oni. E la a o an act of war. He la no o Leandra, the brother Sparky. E wahine kupa a maka aina. E koe maka aina na ku aina o ka aina. Malila ki ola, ke ku e ana. No ka noho ana, ma kō kāko aina, ma makua, ma mua. No leila nui ko aloha mahalo kia poe āpau. Aho mana, wau, ka makaiki umi kumaiwa, kāna walu kumaihiku. Ka makaiki mua. I launa puai me kia poe. Ma ke wahi oi hoi ka, the Sovereign Sunday, ia manawa. Manau ka manau hele na kela au au. Liki pume ke iale nui loa ka poe. E enae. Wa ike ia. Mai kela au a. Ka ho na au au iana kua kako poe. Ke ia lahu I kanaka. A oia ka la au. Oia ka lapa au. No ka kō. Mai ka nao pō e kūho ana. Mau ka nao au. Mau ke ia ike. Mau ka mana. Ko kā kōpō e kupuna. So just tell Brother Andre, I gotta have a... One of those days, just have a difficult time. You should have a lot to say.
But you know, when we speak about those who we truly love and we miss more than we can say, you know, we had great teachers, and not to forget to mention, another of my great teachers, of course, was the great Kihei Sole Niheo. I just had a flashback of him, actually, where his brother Andrew, telling brother Andrew to get out of his way so he could actually see part of a ceremony some years back. And many times when people ask me, oh, Kalekua, if I get nervous, I'm nervous today. If I get afraid to say what I say sometimes. And I never did. And it's really because I know, even to this day, those teachers of mine have always been with me, have always stood with me. And as I always said, you know, I never really care, you know, sometimes when you do political work, a lot of opala out there, a lot of bad things are said out there, and sometimes for our own people. But I knew if I had Kekuni in my corner, I was always on the right side. Kekuni was one of the most dignified people of pure aloha and integrity that I ever knew. And I'll miss that. But at the same time, I know what Kekuni would want me to do anyway, which is to keep on pushing, keep on talking, keep on doing what we all must do. Because our time is going to come when we may all go to the Lena, as we just had three fine leaders, an elite of our people who have passed on recently. But if we really honor, if we're really going to honor Kauka Kekuni and Puhipau and Leandra, it's not enough for us to come here and cry. It's not enough to come here and just talk about the old days and reminisce. Because for them, this struggle, this work that we must do, this hope that we must provide, the faith, mana'o'i o mana'olana, and of course this aloha we have for this place and our people, has to be pushed forward and has to be spread. And for our lahui, I think it's a very difficult times. But I look back, and just recently, let me just share with about a month ago, some of you may have seen on some of the YouTube coverages, there were seven, I think eight of us who tried to present into the Na'iaupuni Aha. Of course, being met in a private facility, on purpose, of course. And in our attempt to bring forward really the concerns and voices of our people, our lahui, tried as best we can, as best we could, to bring those concerns to those who have chosen that particular path of the Aha and Na'iaupuni. You know, I'm going to actually talk about those guys coming up soon. But I remember that day, as we were gathered, getting ready to walk into the gate area, and, you know, some of the concerns of, Kalekua, Andre, what's the plan? People were asking, what's the plan? And for me, it was pretty simple. So we're going to be like Kekuni today. Meaning, we're going to be strong. We're going to be resistant. We're going to hold our integrity. We're going to be disciplined. And most of all, we're gonna love. Most of all, we're gonna love. Most of all, we're gonna love. Even when we know, as many of you who were at the gate that day, we're getting all kinds of stink eyes. A lot of people were upset. How dare we show up at the gate? Who the hell do we think we were as Hawaiians to be asking to attend and submit some verbiage? But in the language, we said, we're going to be like Kekuni. And how Kekuni, as I witnessed many times, sometimes we'd walk, and this is, you know, in the early 90s, sometimes we'd walk into a meeting, maybe a federal meeting, and you walk into the room, and when you walk in, myself, Kekuni, and a couple other people, when you walk in the room, the whole room goes silent one time. And you can feel that tension from those, many of our own people, Hawaiians, would look at us like, what are you guys doing over here? And Kekuni would walk in his very gentleman fashion, full of love, with a big smile, and say, Aloha. Aloha. He never allowed, this is the lesson of Kekuni, he never would allow them to anger, to separate us from our own people, even when our own people may have felt that way against us. And that's a lesson that I learned from Kekuni. This is how much love and aloha he had for his own people. And I remember walking in one time, and his Kekuni voice went, whoa, woo-hoo. Because he could feel the tension. But because Kekuni knew the truth, and he had love for our people, he knew it was necessary. He knew it was necessary to love those even more who may have been duped, manipulated, confused about what is going on. Today, Brother Puhipau, it is worth with Joan. And I think the first time I shot a video with them was, I think, also back in 1987. We did a recruitment for Native Hawaiian students to the University of Hawaii. I had nice short hair back then, I think. But their work with the Makaoka ʻAina, not just educational for our people and generations of our people, but this is the National Archives. Really, the National Archives of our struggles of people. Whether it's from the beginning of Sand Island with their work in Sand Island, to, of course, the great work with the Waimanalo eviction, which even today, when I show my students today, are horrified when they watch visually and hear what it sounds like when Hawaiians are evicted. And this work is priceless. And I thank them for dedicating their lives for this great, bountiful work, which will live on forever, which is really part of the cornerstone to this revival of this Lahui Kanaka. And of course, not just the work of Leandra and Sparky, of course, but, you know, the most thing I remember Leandra and Sparky back in Makua, and that whole gang in Makua. To me, are the fundamentals. Our people fighting to live upon our own lands. Makua again. What is it, 11,000 acres? Maukatu Makai, lands of our people. And who but not our people? Why should not we be living there?
And I tell people, it's not something different from the plight of the homeless. And I say, it really was. It's really the plight of the Hawaiians. Physically making the claim. You see, that's the point. People can talk about, oh, we gotta go here. Oh, Hawaiians, you should do this. But it's really the Maka'aina, it's the Hawaiina who make that step and make that dedicated leap to do what they must. In the end, it's about us living upon our lands. In the end, it's about our people living upon our lands. And so forever, we should always look them as examples of his heroes who made that step. And what are the lessons that we get from them? And especially with Kekuni, you know, Onipa, in the language, the words of our Mo'i Wahine, Lili'o Kalani, Onipa, that we still stay steadfast. Even if you're the only one in the room, we stay steadfast. Because the truth is so powerful. It's not a matter. See, I look at the truth. The truth eventually will always overcome the lies and hatred. It will always overcome. It may take some time. But the truth is so powerful. They may try to erase it. They may try to obliterate it. They may try to confuse us for some time. But the truth is so powerful that one voice will lead to two and two into three. And so the sense of only power, when I look at, again, Kekuni, and you think about this person, professor of medicine, world renowned, highly educated, and at the core of his being was his sense of his identity and loyalty to this truth, to the truth of our history, that we as a people, as Alahui Kanaka, it's not that we have a moral right, legal right. We are this Lahui Kanaka. That's simple. That's all it is. That is the foundation. And as long as you teach that love and the true history, it not will just continue, but it will grow. The other great qualities of these leaders was this love, this everlasting love they had for humanity. It wasn't just about native Hawaiians in a sense, but really in the end, loving all peoples of this world, that all peoples have a right to live in dignity. All peoples have a place in the sun. And this place in the sun will never be given to us. See, that's the lesson. We have to understand in this situation, we as the Lahui Kanaka today, and I'm talking right here, 2016, we are still a very dominated people. I repeat, we are a dominated people. I mean, somebody may say, well, I'm not dominated. Well, maybe you're not dominated. But as a people, we are. But one of the reasons that we are dominated, you see, this is the point to understand, is that we have been taught to become complicit in this domination. And this complicitness into this domination really comes from a lack of understanding of who we are and our history. But, as I say, what is the remedy? What is the lapa'au to end this domination as a people? It is our education. It is our consciousness. It is our love for who we are and our history. See, that's what's going to rattle the chains. And I remember Kauai Puna Puijin, as he always says, You know, no worry about the chains on our legs. Worry about the chains on our brains. Because you got chains in your brains, you don't need chains on your legs, you see, to learn to be obedient and docile and accepting and complicit in the destruction of your homeland. So the key to this whole evolution, now these are evolutions of people, is the raising of the consciousness of our people. Now what's up, it's not about you, it's not about me, it's about the we. As the great Muhammad Ali, great poet said, and I always use this to my students, everybody repeat with me, everybody say me,
me.
We.
We,
me,
me.
We.
We.
And see, that's the lapa'au. We must think as Alahui Kanaka. See, once we start to think as Alahui Kanaka, it's not about our personal gains. It's not about their gains. It's not about entitlements. It's not about, ooh, I wonder what kind of laws we can sneak through Congress. I wonder what kind of rules we can play with the DOI. Because in the end, it makes no difference what they want to do, you see. The difference comes from what we want to do. See, that's the point we understand. Part of the confusion today, people get so confused. Oh, I wonder what Congress, I wonder what DOE, DOI. Now, they're getting all worked up about what they are doing to us. This is part of the confusion, misleading us to a reactive politics. They're reacting to what they do to us. They draw a circle, we jump in the circle, thinking that's the fight. When reality, the fight, if you want to call it the fight, is amongst us. The key to our salvation, the key to our liberation, the key to a better future for all of us, is us. Who needs to educate us? Us. Who needs to organize us? Us. Who needs to feed our people? It's us. The root of our reemergence, revitalization, rebirth, re-empowerment is about us looking at each other. And there's a famous Hawaiian saying, Akupuna, Vaya Kupuna, E Ike Kahoa Kanaka, O Kipa Heva, Kealoha Ika Ilio. E Ike Kahoa Kanaka, look to your fellow Kanaka. See them, know your fellow Kanaka. O Kipa Heva, lest the love, aloha, is wasted on the dog. But this Olelo Mo'iao made us to understand, we gotta see us. See, that is the foundation to the question of unity. For myself, I would say, unity. Unity is the key ingredient to this future. The only reason we are not unified is because as a dominated people, it's the role of the dominator. See, the dominator creates the situations to, as they say, divide and conquer. We will never have unity holding the hand of the dominator. Hawaiians will never have political unity, economic unity, looking at the state of Hawaii, looking at the federal government, looking at these multinational corporations to say, this is what we gotta do. See, once you talk about that as the we, you realize we're not unified. Because part of the we are the victims of the state of Hawaii, the federal government, and the multinational corporations. So let me just jump right into part of the question of Nayaupuni. From the very foundation, and in honor of Kekuni and those two, let's talk some politics. Let's talk live. From Act 195 in 2011, and you all should read Act 195. In fact, what was amazing, that day when we were at the gates speaking to some of the so-called delegates or participants or whatever they call themselves now of this AHA. And I asked them, what did you like about Act 195? And several of them said, what is Act 195? They had no idea that they were participating in a process that was partly birthed from Act 195. And one of the things you notice about Act 195, this is that process of state recognition, as it was called. This is the so-called Royal Commission, the birth of Kana'i Olovalu, which, by the way, were written by several legislators, right back there, and signed by whom? Governor Abercrombie. Also given the authority to select he, knowing what's best for Kanaka, would select the so-called board or a committee. All of whom, by the way, are all well-known pro-Federal, Washington, D.C., Democratic Party Hawaiians. You can see the setup already. And their job was to go around and to create a role. Yeah, a role, we understand, and as Andrea always talks about it, I don't know if you talked about it, how roles are used. Roles are used not for American Indians or Native Americans, but have always been used against Native Americans, American Indians. And from this role, they were supposed to create this constitutional convention to get recognition. But when you read through that document, first of all, it talks about Captain Cook in 1778. What's the big deal about Captain Cook? I don't know. Somehow we became Hawaiians when he came around. And how we were indigenous in 1778. Talks through some history, a little, and then jumps through 1959 statehood. That's the truth. It doesn't even talk about the great history of our kupuna, the humanity of our kupuna, and their accomplishments, especially in the 1800s, in the Hawaiian Kingdom period. None of that. And you got to ask the question, why is that? Why would you keep out what happens in 1843 in Hawaii's securing its recognition as an independent nation state? Why would you keep that out? Why would you keep out the countless treaties that the Hawaiian Kingdom had, not just with the United States, which we had five, by the way, but with many of the powers across the world? Why would you keep that out? Why would you keep the history of our people in 1854 declaring ourselves, you know, this sense of neutrality? Why would you keep that out? These are all honorable historical facts. And the truth, of course, is you keep that out because you really don't want the question of sovereignty or the question of independence in the conversation. Because, if you're talking Hawaii was a sovereign nation state, how does it now fit into the realm of Indian and federal Indian law? Which, by the way, you have to also, we got to understand, playing defense, what is American Indian federal law about? And there are many great books out there you all should read. But one of the things you all should understand is what's called the Marshall Trilogy. If you never heard about the Marshall Trilogy, go understand the Marshall Trilogy. The Marshall Trilogy are the three cornerstones of what become American Indian federal law. This is like Indian law, how Indians are governed and controlled as domestic population comes from these three cases, what's called the Marshall Trilogy. Marshall being the head Supreme Court judge. And this happens in the early 1820s. And the first case
the Macintosh case, basically says this, that the reason that the Europeans own the American continent and the Indians, you don't own any of this land, is through what they call the doctrine of discovery, which on the international law basically says a place can be discovered as long as the people are non-European and non-Christian, and therefore savages, less than human being, and they don't really own the land. So what does it say about title to American Indian land from the get-go? It says, American Indians, sorry, you don't own the land. You have right of occupancy. That's the language. Right of occupancy, whatever that may be. They also say in this trilogy that Congress shall have plenary power, meaning in the end, you can call yourself what you like, you can be whatever you like, but in the end, Congress, the U.S. Congress, has total authority over you. And the third is this sense of a trust relationship is now developed, that American Indians are a domestic population. Listen to their language. They're a domestic population, meaning they're not sovereign, although they use that kind of language. But domestic population means that you are within, yeah, the confines of the population of the United States. So whose laws trumps? And if you follow, whose laws trumps? American Indian law or the U.S. Constitution? The U.S. Constitution, correct. So when you look at the Hawaiian case, it's easy to understand. Why wouldn't you talk about our true history? Because once you start talking about our true history, you realize, well, it doesn't fit the doctrine of discovery, because we were never discovered. Domestic population? How does a country that had five treaties with the United States as co-equals under international law now pretend to be, oh, we just want domestic population? And thirdly, the sense of a trust relationship, the sense of being a domestic, that somehow the question goes again, when did U.S. Congress have authority over the Hawaiian Islands? See, that's the heart of the matter. When? What year? Did it happen in 1897? Well, we should know the answer to that one. Of course, we know the second major attempt to have the Hawaiian Islands annexed or ceded to the United States fails. Happens in 1898, the Newlands Resolution. The Newlands Resolution, Well, again, resolution, as we all understand, has territorial limits. The United States law can only has power within the confines of the United States territory. But when does Hawaii become part of the United States as a territory? Well, it doesn't. Never has. So these are points to understand. You see, when you deal with Hawaii in the true history, when you understand and you talk about Hawaii in its true form, during the kingdom period, it's like oil with water, it cannot mix. You cannot put a sovereign, independent nation state with treaties around the world, with recognition, and try to stick them into American Indian federal law, which has its own history. It doesn't fit. Aha! Unless you can get some of these so-called Native Hawaiians to buy into the story that really what is best for our people is to pretend, perhaps, let's not talk about that history. Let's not talk about the Hawaiian Kingdom period at all. We were a nation in 1778.
That's it. And if you look at the language, if you look at the language of Act 195, and then if you look at the language, this so-called constitution that was created by this AHA, you quickly realize that is why these language, this history is not within that document, you see. Because how you take that document that Hawaii was a sovereign independent nation, now go to the DOI, or go to Congress, or go begging Obama for some kind of executive to say, hey, but we like be like them. When from the foundation, we were never politically, like, I'm not saying culturally, I'm talking politically, like American Indians. See, that's the great deception. But, as I just said, what destroys that deception? But our education and the truth. You see, this is in the end what's going to be the bomb, in a sense, that will destroy, and I have no fear saying that, the federalities. Because in the end, they cannot deny that, well, they can deny, close their eyes, pretend. But that history is true. See, it's one thing for them to say, that's our history, and say, but as a tactic, perhaps we want to do this. Maybe. But, you know, when you got to hide something that tells you there's something wrong, there's something rotten, something pilau there that's going on, who else benefits from this BS history? Well, the state of Hawaii. Because what about these lands here? If we never mention they actually belong to the Hawaiian kingdom, maybe we don't have to ever, ever, ever return control of these lands to our people, to our Lahui Kanaka. So again, the language is used, and so far, as we know, language like ceded lands are used, which is again part of deception. Lands that were never ceded. Or the best, of course, oh, those are all stolen Hawaiian lands. Even worse. Stolen? I don't know. I still see them right here. You see, that's consciousness. Think about that. Nothing has ever been stolen. But you get caught. You see, I get something stolen. I can't get them back, you see, right? Stolen? Oh, shucks, man. Hawaiians, you're not going to get them back. It's not stolen if it's still here. Again, that's the consciousness that this is a lot for ours right here. For us to continue to say and teach others to say, these are our lands. Lands that belong to our people. These are not state lands. And that's the lapa'au. So that's why their job is to obliterate this history. Is to pretend that somehow, neatly, Hawaiians just happen to become Americans. And I've asked this question many times, and many others out there know that question, and they ask that also. And I encourage you to always go and ask, when did Hawaiians become Americans? Never. What year? Never. What was the instrument, the legal instrument? And my students, they all know this too. In fact, about 4 months ago, we had former congressional woman Hanabusa come tomorrow. As you guys know, she's cruising around with the DOI Hawaiian Homes kind of language right now, going around meeting in the community. And so some Hawaiians called and said, hey, Kaliko, get some guys like me about Hawaiian Homes and some language stuff. Can we set up something at the college? We said, sure, we set up the meeting, right? Invite the community. Then, oh, Hanabusa talking. Okay. And the next thing you know, it stopped being like about Hawaiian Homes. The next thing you know, it's about how Hawaiians, you should get on the ball and work these DUI rules to get federal recognition. And of course, those in the room look at me like, oh, Kalekua, how come you're giving her this rule? Like, it's like, you know, I was somehow supporting what was being said. But I quickly stood up and I asked her directly. I asked Hanabusa directly. I said, before we start talking about DUI rules and Department of Interior, let me ask you. And I said, well, you as an attorney, a trained legal person, a congressional woman, someone that's been around law for many, many years. And I asked her, can you tell me what law transformed the Hawaiian nationals, citizens, Hawaiians, into U.S. citizens, into Americans? And then she kind of went off for a while, and, you know, so I had to raise my hand again and say, wait, I'm asking you again directly. And this went on 3 times. She never answered the question. And then finally I stood up, I said, obviously, in front of my students and my fellow friends, you're choosing not to answer that question because you cannot answer that question. And if you cannot answer that question, that is informing all of us that you don't have not just the answer, but in fact, all that you are pushing, in fact, is not just wrong, but it's based upon false analysis and lies. You see, that's the thing as Hawaiians. If we're going to do anything together as a people, we got to subjugate our brains into looking at the truth and having the best analysis. Not closing our eyes and just guessing and listening to whoever, whatever they may say. And I asked her again, and I said, can you tell me, just give me the year, I make it that easy. And she kind of, and then she said, 1959. I said, really? So prior to 1959, Hawaiians were Americans now? You see, because even for their logic and argument, that throws them off too now. Because prior to 1959, Hawaiians were voting in the territorial period, you see. But you see, when you lie, what happens when you lie? You gotta lie again, and then you lie again, you gotta make a bigger lie, and a bigger lie, you gotta get a bigger lie. And eventually the lie gets so big that all you can do is keep on lying. Even when you get caught red-handed. Or I should say red-handed, white-handed maybe better. And that's why I preach education. I preach everyone to learn as much as you can and to share as much as you can. And if you cannot learn, support somebody that can. I'm not a legal expert at all. That's why I listen to my legal friends. I'm no historian at all. I'm a good storyteller, but I'm not a historian. But I listen to them and their research. And I support all the endeavors. And this is the power that we still have. See, that's the bottom line. This is what the fight will be about. The fight is about the minds and hearts of our people. The fight in the future will be about the minds and hearts. The truth is, there will be some of our people, because of circumstances, collaboration, maybe monetary participation, whatever it might be, who will choose the easier path, who will choose the path to say, we better just take the scraps off the table. Because they're out there. Like, I just want to end by talking a little bit about 20 years ago now. I was going to say 10 years ago. 20 years ago, some of you, I think, maybe must have remembered, but Kwame Ture came to Hawaii on one of his trips, and the late Kwame Ture, peace on him, of course, also known as Stukely Carmichael, had come to speak in Hawaii, and he gave a powerful speech. And for me, it changed my total outlook in regards to politics. And his basic lesson was this: only our culture will give us the answers. The answers to where we gotta go and what we gotta do can only come from our cultural understanding. It may be inspired from other underlearnings, but in the end, it has to come from this understanding. Let me give you an example. When they talk federal recognition, I always say, is that ea o ka ʻaina? What is the language of our people? What is the word for federal recognition? See, that tells you right there, it's not even a Hawaiian concept. Ea o ka ʻaina is important. First of all, ea is not defined by any Western law, legal library. It's not in the U.S. Constitution. But it's a true guiding principle of our people. It also doesn't say heir of that constitution or heir of that king or queen or the heir of that sovereign or that government. But the heir of what? ʻĀina. If you look at the language of the so-called constitution of the ʻaha, I don't even know where to start when I took that thing apart. They talk about Native Hawaiian national lands. Well, first of all, what were ever the Native Hawaiian national lands? They go, well, you know, click on, in 1778, the Native Hawaiians just say, okay. So when you say Native Hawaiian, you're talking about all the archipelago. Oh, no, not the whole archipelago. Okay, so which Native Hawaiian national lands are you talking about now? In the Hawaiian kingdom, was it a Native Hawaiian government? I want you to think about that. Was that the term? Was it a Native Hawaiian? Did we ever have a Native Hawaiian government? See, this confusion. First of all, Native Hawaiian wasn't created. In 1775, Kaikili guys wasn't walking around calling themselves Native Hawaiians. You understand this guy? This is, in other words, this is not even looking at ourselves as Kanaka. You gotta use a definition provided from somebody else, thousands of miles, 5,000 miles away, to define who you. So when I look at the document, I think, geez, how crazy. You're gonna have a constitution, but you cannot even have one formed from your own here as a people. And you still gotta define yourself from somebody in Washington, D.C., thousands of miles away. And even that language of a Native Hawaiian national lands, and in there, actually, if you look at the document, they say conveyed, or to be conveyed to them. Remember, conveyed. If somebody conveys you something, what does that mean? It means it's not yours. If I convey to you my land, whose land was conveyed? Was my land. So they don't make claim to lands to be conveyed. Again, it's like, what are they talking about? Rabbit Island? I mean, what are you guys talking about out there? And then ask the question. When you ask the question, what land exactly are you talking about? In Hawaii you say ho-a-a. Ho-a-a is a a-a-a. That's the truth. But you see, this is part of that BS bullshit reality they gotta create. Because for American Indians, that's how they're dealt with. Native Americans, American Indians. That's not who they are. That's federal language placed on them. And what are their lands? Well, whatever lands the so-called federal government decides that they can occupy. Not to own, but to occupy. See, that's a box. That's why, going back to the question, why from the very beginning, many of us who aided this process, because from the very beginning, the process was filthy lies. And it's also a process which was meant to divide our people, because they knew many of us could not sign on to a process, not just created by the legislature empowered by Abercrombie, but when you actually read the actual law, it's not just missing part of our history, it's actually an imposter history that's put in there. Not because that's what's best for our people, because that's what's best to fit into American Indian legal legislation and law. See, that's the bottom line. That's the purpose. So today, when we speak out against what's occurring, we quickly understand it's no coincidence that the AHA at first said, yeah, no worry, you guys. We got to go ratify them out there. Next thing you know, Nayapuni not going to ratify, you're going to get funding sources. By the way, just to understand, you guys should go do your research and realize where are some of those monies are going to come from. And I'm not going to give hearsay, but I can just tell you pretty clearly, as I said, you know, we have compradors in our people. We have people who make money, who fatten their wallets and checkbooks off of our oppression with slick contracts, because money comes down, and the story is that they're going to help to provide monies. Now, who's going to ratify this document again? You see, again, just that population. So from the very foundation, it was never a Hawaiian nation. You see, understand again, it was never a Hawaiian nation, a Hawaiian national document. From the foundation, it was created, birthed, controlled for just to be a participation of, and I would argue clearly, a minority of Hawaiians. Many of them, first of all, do not understand this history, as we all know, or two, may not care. And this is the lapa'au. You see, this is where we must go and challenge. And it's not going to be easy. Go back to Kwame Ture. That was the first thing he said. He also said this, and I spoke to him. He said, Kalikua, what's your worst fear? And I said, go get one Federal Office of Hawaiian Affairs. And he said this to me directly. He says, it shall come to pass. And he said, but don't fear it. He said, when this occurs, you know you're getting closer. See, the oppressor never going to give you what you need or what you want. The oppressor only going to give you what they have to. You see, that's the point. So they're gonna give, it's like they're giving off just the crumbs off the table. So the Hawaiians was catching maybe the small crumbs. So now they might throw a couple big pieces off the table for some of the Hawaiians. But what he meant was that, and he said also, he said, when you get to that point, it's going to get harder. But when it gets harder, your people are going to get stronger. And as your people get stronger, they're going to even fight back even harder. Because the oppressor, by their nature, will never just set us free. You know, the great Frederick Douglass said what? There's no struggle, there's no progress. That power never concedes. Those who benefit off our oppression, those who benefit of that, you know, they love that money. They love their profits. And they're not quickly going to give it up. And that's why it becomes more and more necessary for us to even get stronger. But at the same time, as we get stronger, we got to become more and more clear in our objectives. As we get more and more clear, we're going to get more and more information, more and more education to put to the masses. Because as the sign says back here, going back to the words of our great Mo'i Wahine, the voice of the people is the voice of God. The voice of the people. Remember the DOI hearings? Just wait till they try to come back again. And that kind of tells you something about the AHA again. Why did they have to go hide behind gates? Because in the end, this is what they're afraid of. In the end, they also understand they are illegitimate. They were created dishonestly. They were created with the intent of disunity. They're created with the idea to maintain the benefit of the oppressors over our people. This is why they were birthed. It had nothing to do, I repeat, it had nothing to do with bettering the conditions of our people, as may some may tell you this. Because if it's really about benefiting our people, I would just simply look at those who participated, especially those who gave a thumbs up yes vote, and look at them and evaluate them, and we all should evaluate them and critique them for what they do in our communities. And I would simply suggest many of those faces and voices are not in our communities, are not in our communities working for better education, working for better housing, working to protect our sacred lands. And I kind of laugh that somehow they would even think that somehow they would perhaps negotiate Mauna Kea. Well, they better tell us, guys, who there for them. But if you understand history, you realize collaborators always make their way to that position. As the American Indians used to call them, yeah, the Around the Fort Indians. They're the first one in line, fighting over the biggest scraps of the table. And those are the ones many times don't really care if anybody else eat, as long as they get to eat first. See, this way you can tell the true leader, the true leader will eat last. The love of the people will eat last after the people eat. They won't be up in the front of the table grabbing the biggest pieces and then decide if maybe you should have a lick or a taste of the pieces that they grab. And I remember having this conversation with one that told me once before, you know, it's like I get my lao lao and everybody like my lao lao. And I said, you see, that's a funny way of thinking. As I was taught as a Hawaiian, if only get one lao lao, who eat first? The one who grab them first? We feed the keiki. We feed the kupuna. We feed the weakest. The one who needs it the most first. And the strongest, they eat last. And that's the kind of, my point is, this is the kind of fundamental kind of political kind of ideas we got to have and understand to evaluate those who want to claim to somehow speak on our behalf. And I look at those faces and I wonder, and in fact, I was shocked that day when I showed up. Many of those, they showed up, I mean, they came out with full suits. I mean. What the F? Think about that. Like you're putting on one costume. You see, when you pretend, you gotta pretend all the way. That's how they do them in D.C. That's how we're gonna do them too. But that told me something, you see, about that. That kind of, it's so clear that they value themselves in some capacity, thinking that somehow they earned the right to speak for our people. And a kupuna left their language. Ialii no ke alii ke kanaka. Ialii no ke alii ke kanaka. Ialii no ke alii ke kanaka. The alii is an alii because of the people. It's the people. It's the people that make our alii. You're not an alii if you don't got any people. You can dress like an alii. You can try to talk like an alii. You can pretend all you like. You can have the most fanciest words on the paper. And it means nothing without the people. Because whatever they should be writing in such a document should come from whom? From the people. I really don't care what is said in this law review or that legal document. Or for me, I'm concerned what comes from the voices of our people, first of all. See, the guidance has already been given to us. It's real easy to see how many of our people are being manipulated into this situation, misled. blinded. Talks of negotiations. As if somehow they have... Who the F gave them the right to even negotiate on our behalf again? But I know, when you look what's going on with our people, and we can look at Mauna Kea and Haleakala, for example. That came from the people, from the land, who rose up and stood up and said, no more. We'll make a stand. We'll defend. We'll speak. We'll confront. And it doesn't matter what the Office of Hawaiian Affairs said. We don't give a crap whatever documents they signed, negotiated, whatever entitlements that we're going to get for that mountain. It's meaningless to us. You see, that's the bottom line. I want to see Peter or Paul come up to the mountain and tell us to leave. But you see, in their confusion, in their narcissism, they somehow believe that they represent our people. Failing to understand, no, you actually represent the voters of the state of Hawaii, not our people. That's a fact. So somehow to pretend that you represent us is not just a fallacy. I say it's actually a sickness. It's a sickness of false empowerment. It's a sickness of this collaborated bourgeois mentality. That somehow, when the master said, you're a good old slave, they actually believe there's such a thing as a good old slave. You see, that's the problem. You know, as Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X clearly talked about, the field slave and the house slave. And that's exactly what's going on here. The house slave is only looking for a better place in a master's house. The house slave is only looking for the masters to say, good boy, good girl. Because the master, the house slave never challenges the master's authority. They accept the master's authority. But we the field slaves, we know that's not our master. We know that master, whatever documents, he may have 1,000 documents saying he owns our ass. But he doesn't. The master can preach anything to say somehow he's entitled to what is ours. But we know in our hearts he doesn't. And the master will create the division between the house slave and the field slave, you see. So we accept that also. But we also accept, it's just a matter of time, Master. We're coming for you, Master. Well, yes, we are, Master. We're coming. As our numbers increase, as we get stronger, you think Mauna Kea was big? You wait and see. As more and more of our young people get more and more educated, as more and more of the academics and the story and the history of our people become stronger and stronger, as more and more of our identity gets there, stronger and stronger, more and more of us stand and rise, and we get stronger and stronger. It's just a matter of time, Master, because we're coming, Master. Anyway, mahalo nui, aloha ʻaina ʻo ia iʻo.
Firebrand speaker, Kalekoa Kaʻeo. For those of you who don't know, Kalekoa is a professor of Hawaiian studies, Hawaiian language at Maui Community College. And one of our great analysts, activists, political theorists, which was obvious. Okay, so from this point, we're gonna take a quick break. We're going to set up the screen and the projector and watch the tribunal, and we have some other video footage that we'll be showing. So maybe we could koku a little bit. We want to kind of clear out the chairs, move them maybe back in this big tent right in front of me. kind of move the chairs back so we can make hali'i in the front area. And we'll be setting up a screen right here and showing the video probably in about 15 minutes. Mahalo.